them another. And I know you probably noticed the nativity scene was already done over there. And I know you're probably thinking, wait a minute, isn't this the end? Isn't this how the Christmas play always ends? We have Mary and Joseph and baby Jesus. And you're right, that's the way we usually end it. And no, gentlemen, you did not fall asleep and miss the play.
Turn off the motion.
We all know the end of the Christmas story. But do you know why we have a Christmas story? Let me take you back to the beginning. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth.
That he was going to give his one and only son
to save the world. And whoever believed in his son would be saved and have everlasting life. But God wasn't going to do this alone. He was going to reveal his plan to some of his people. But who? Who did God reveal his plan to? Here are three of God's prophets that he chose to use. Listen to what they told God's people.
Hello, I am the prophet Isaiah. I'm here to tell you, we all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us turned to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of all of us. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
You, Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, are by no means least among the rulers of Judea, for out of you will come a ruler who will be the shepherd of my people, Israel.
Hello, I am the prophet Malachi, and the Lord says, see, I will send my messenger, who will prepare the way before me. Then suddenly, the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant, whom you desire, will come.
Isaiah's prophecy that a virgin would give birth to the Messiah? Wow! Can you imagine what every woman and every girl was thinking each time they heard those words read to them? Is it me? Could God use me? These were important prophecies for God's people. It let them know that God had not forgotten them. Through these prophets, God had given his people hope. Hope that someday their Savior would come. But after Malachi's last words, God's people would hear no more from God. No more prophets, no more thus says the Lord. For 400 years, they did not hear from God. But they did have the prophecies that had been recorded and passed down through generation to generation. And each time they heard the words of the Lord, their hope grew.
In the scroll of Micah, my children, says, but you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will be the shepherd of my people Israel. Children, what do you think of that?
Mary, do you ever think about who their virgin will be?
Another one told me that. Heard the things to speak about the male girls. We all wonder who God will be.
What about us? Hey, what about you, Mary?
Yeah, Mary, what if God shall use to give birth to the Messiah?
You will give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High.
How can this be, since I am a virgin?
The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And so the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God.
Because he will save his people from their sins. have fun. Mary. 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 An angel appeared to me, and he said he would give birth to the Messiah.
God had revealed his plan to Mary and Joseph through his angel Gabriel. And they were quick to answer and agree to do what God had asked them to do. Now let's see who else knew about God's plan and how it was revealed to them. God had revealed his plan to Elizabeth because her baby, who would be named John, would grow up to be a prophet of the Most High, and he would go before the Lord and prepare the way for him.
No, the grave. Christ the everlasting Lord, he shall reign forevermore. Come and see your God and
you. bow before our Savior. Come, let us adore the one who came for us. Glory in the highest, praise the name of Jesus, our King is come.
John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." Sin had come into the world, but God still loved us. Romans 5:8, "But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us." God loved us so much that he chose to give his one and only Son, Jesus. Jesus took all our sins upon him and died on the cross for us so that we could be called children of God and live with him forever and ever. I'd like to read to you a quote from a book I read. It says, "Oh, the love it took for God to send his only Son to die in the place of humans. And the love it took to keep Jesus up there on that cross when he could have easily come down from it. Life had been transformed for all of humanity with that act of immeasurable love. God's plan of redemption. God has always, always had a plan. The book of Jeremiah says, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you." In Psalms 33, it says, "But the plans of the Lord stand firm forever."
Amen.
God has a plan for me. God has a plan for you. It doesn't matter what we've done in the past. The mistakes we've made, it doesn't matter. Nothing is too horrible for God to forgive. And that's what he wants to do. All we have to do is ask. The worship team has one more song, and then I'll turn it over to Pastor Joe. But before that, I want to let you know that as you leave here today, Lydia and Kim will be at the doors, and they have a small gift for you. It's a Christmas ornament in the shape of a heart. Hang it on your tree. And then when you take your tree down, don't put it away. Hang it somewhere. You'll see it every day. And let it be a reminder of God's love for you. Remember, Christmas is about love. It's the greatest gift of all. All we have to do is accept it and open it. Now listen as the worship team sings, "Oh, How He Loves."
Thank you.
bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me.
Oh, how he loves us. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. You may be seated for a moment. The phone rang. It was a Tuesday night. It was the 18th of December, 1 week to the day before Christmas. I was a 24-year-old young man pastoring my first church. The church was located just 15 miles from where I had graduated from high school. And as the phone rang that evening, it was one of my classmates, a friend. Her family didn't attend church and they didn't know a preacher except she knew me. And as I spoke that evening, I found out that she had just lost her father 1 week to the day before Christmas. They had gone out and bought him a nice recliner. The children had gathered together to buy their dad a nice gift. He'd been sickly, but they looked forward to the Christmas day, just 1 week away. And as she said, "My dad's dead. We don't know anybody else to turn to." They inquired if I would conduct the funeral of her dad. I thought to myself, as a young man, Christmas is 1 week away and we celebrate the birth of a child. We celebrate the birth of a baby. And here is a family going to bury the patriarch of the family, the father. Being young, I didn't know how to go about preaching the funeral at Christmas, especially of somebody that I knew quite well. But I accepted the invitation quite readily, and as I began to pray about it and I began to ask God how I should go about it, I began to realize that the very purpose, the very reason that the babe came, born in a barn, placed in a manger, was for the very reason that he would grow into manhood and die on the cross. And if the purpose of Christmas was really death, but if we would accept that death, we'd find life. So I preached a message entitled, "What is Christmas All About, Death or Life?" The truth of the matter is, it's a little of both. Jesus was born to die. The Bible tells us in Romans 5:7, "Scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Peradventure for a good man some may die." But verse 8 says, as we heard already Cherry declare, "But God commended his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." The Bible said, "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man will lay down his life for his friend." But Jesus did not wait till we became his friend before he laid his life down. He died while we were his enemy. Talk about love. "Greater love hath no man." He didn't have to be born, and he didn't have to die. It was a sacrifice, if you would ask me, that he would leave the splendor and the glory of a perfect heaven to slip into the skin of humanity, being divinity, and step in to a sinful world and live a life that he didn't have to live, but he chose so that he could pay the price that we couldn't afford. What love. I can't imagine dying for somebody who didn't like me. were shed, I couldn't imagine laying my life down for somebody who not only didn't like me, but actually rejected me. Even more than that, I really couldn't imagine laying my life down for somebody who was willing to crucify me. They killed me. Yeah, we know the Christmas story and we know that a Savior is born, but why? That's what the program was about today. Why? Why? Because greater love has no man than this, than a man to lay down his life for his friend. And the reason he was born was so he could die, so we could live. Wow. If that doesn't boggle the mind, if that doesn't cause you to question, if that doesn't cause you to search your heart, how do you respond to somebody who loves you that much? I heard a lady preacher, she's a black lady preacher, I have spoken for her in the past, and I heard her at one time preach, and I kind of stole her sermon. She took an old song that said, I'm gonna make you love me. Yes, I will. Yes, I will. I'm gonna make you love me. She began to talk about when they brought him down from where he had stood above the crowd, and when they were given an opportunity to release Christ or Barabbas, the crowd chose Barabbas. And they brought Jesus down into the courtyard and they stripped him of his robe and they put a whip in the hand of a brute of a soldier. And they took the robe off the back of the master who came down meek and mild, and they brought that whip high and brought it down hard. And as the whip connected with the flesh tore, the muscle ripped, the blood flowed, and Christ instantly winced in pain. With the first blow of that whip, he said, I'm going to make you love me. Yes, I will. Yes, I will. The soldier took the whip and he brought it high again and brought it down harder still. And it tore and it ripped and it began to just separate the flesh again, and more blood began to flow. And on the second crack of the whip and the second rip of the flesh, Jesus was saying, I'm going to make you love me. Yes, I will. Yes, I will. And the third, and the fourth, and the fifth, and the sixth, and the seventh, and the eighth, and the ninth, and the tenth, and the 11th, and the 12th, and the 13th, and the 14th, and the 15th lash. I'm going to make you love me. And the 16th. The 17th, and the 18th, and the 19th, and the 20th. I'm going to make you love me. Yes, I will. And the 21st, and the 22nd, and the 23rd, and the 24th, and the 25th. I'm going to make you love me. And the 26th, and the 27th, and the 28th, and the 29th, and the 30th, and the 31st, 32nd. 33rd, the 34th, 35th, I'm going to make you love me. The 36th, the 37th, the 38th, and the 39th lash, he was saying, I'm going to make you love me. Yes, I will. Yes, I will. And when they stopped the beating, they placed a cross on his shoulder and they instructed him to carry it to the top of the mountain. He struggled and fell. And Simon the Cyrene helped him and assisted him to the top, where they took a crown, not made of gold, but of thorns, and they pressed it into his brow and into his skull. And he began to bleed from the head and bleach his hair red, and he began to cry in the innermost being, saying, I'm gonna make you love me. Yes, I will. Yes, I will. And when he finished putting a crown of thorns on his head, they began to beat him with their fists. And they beat him so hard, and they beat him so much that his face was disfigured and marred. You couldn't even recognize him. And with a beating of the fist, he was saying, I'm going to make you love me. Yes, I will. Yes, I will. When they finished the beating, they took the cross and laid it on the ground, and they put him against it and drawed his hand back and began to pound a nail, piercing the flesh and fixing it to the rugged timber. And there they brought the other hand back, and with each blow of the hammer that struck the nail that pierced his palm, he was saying, I'm gonna make you love me. Yes, I will. Yes, I will. I'm gonna make you love me. Yes, I will. Yes, I will. When they finally raised the cross and they dropped it into a pit, they had dug to hold it in place, and it came to that jolting, jerking, sudden stop, and the splinters of the rough-hewn timber penetrated his raw, beaten back, and the pain was just excruciating. And he slumped as his head began to bow, and he began to breathe his final breath. But before he said it, he declared, it is finished. I'm gonna make you love me. Yes, I will. How can you resist somebody who would love you that much?